Windows 3.1. When it came along in 1992, it immediately became a huge success, doing away with the instabilities that plagued the earlier Windows 3.0 and selling millions of copies worldwide. No wonder Microsoft initially included the possibility to run Windows 3.1 natively at the time development on the next major release, Windows 4.0, aka Chicago, began. Ultimately dropped from the final release, it still can be run on Windows 95 and Windows 98.
What about Windows Me?
Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the vintage collector, and these are my stories. It's one of these weird things that don't seem to make any sense. Why would Microsoft even think of including the possibility to run Windows 3.1 on top of Windows 95? We remember Bill Gates himself proclaimed the ultimate compatibility for Windows 95 at the launch event in 1995.
This product is compatible with the vast majority of all the current hardware and software that's out there.
Also, I remember well that the Windows 95 demo disc, which essentially was nothing more than an animated tour through Windows 95's new capabilities, was given away for free and included with literally every computer magazine out there. And although we used OS 2 at home, the new 95 UI intrigued me, spawned my hunger for more. It looked so fresh, so modern. Today, it is even hard to imagine a Windows release without a start menu. No, we don't discuss that one with strangers. I did some investigation and found this website pointing to some interesting bits, though, as always, sometimes it's better to try it out yourself. So I went to install Chicago build 81 from January 1994. I ran this off a working MS-DOS 6 and Windows 3.1 installation, although opting to conduct a fresh install of Chicago into its own directory. You'll be asked for a beta site ID and password during the setup, but you'll find this easily on winwillpc.com. And it could have been so easy, and it failed right away with an obscure general error 57. After reading around, I found that a better release to try is build 116, which is still rough around the edges but more stable. The wallpaper they used for the setup program is similar in style to the one we got on the Windows 95 final release. But it has just one funny thing that made me giggle. Did you see it? No? Look here, they put the Microsoft mouse to the left-hand side of the keyboard. A right-handed mouse, I mean.
Nah, that's not particularly funny, no.
Anyways, the advanced configuration dialog here brings up the option to again define the target directory. But yet another thing that was ultimately dropped from the final Windows 95 release spawns my interest. What is this Windows 3.1 file system compatibility mode?
I think you should stick to the topic.
Then let's skip all these interesting beta bits. Ultimately, I would end up on the Chicago desktop, which has this link to the Chicago beta release notes. Looking through the document, I'll find this chapter talking about running Windows 3.1 in a VM. Although I personally don't think they meant a virtual machine, as in our present day's understanding, but in the sense of a virtual DOS machine, as it was state of the art back then. Now, according to this documentation, I'm supposed to go to the c:\windows\system directory and copy over the two files win31.exe and win31.pif to the actual directory where Windows 3.1 is installed. In addition to that, I have to adapt system.ini. I'll take a backup before editing it, pointing the mouse.drv and com.drv config statements to the replacement drivers again found beneath c:\windows\system. As a last step, you'll have to edit the win31.pif file, changing the path of the command line and the working directory to the proper location where Windows 3.1 was installed, in my case c:\win31. To show some comfort, I'll also quickly add a program link to the start menu, pointing it to c:\win31\win31.pif. And since I like eye candy, I'll also swap the default icon against the default icon of procman.exe, the Windows 3.x program manager. Now, will it work? Oh yes it does! And it has the small icon in the lower left corner calling return to Chicago. Now, does as well someone think this looks familiar? Check this out, how they have done it for Windows 3.1 when running a so-called WinOS 2 on their OS 2. Or here for the OS 2 presentation manager when it runs on Windows NT. It seems this little trick was very much a standard routine for switching between instances. After all, I now have a standard Windows 3.1 running on top of Windows 95. It can't run the MS-DOS prompt, and calling the control panel will yield a segmentation fault, but apart from that, it seems to be fully running. I was then quickly installing a contemporary Microsoft Works, and that seems to work just fine. On the contrary to Chicago, which would be repeatedly locking up when running the Microsoft Works installer natively. And although one should not judge prematurely, and this is definitely a beta version still, it's maybe indicative as to why Microsoft may have thought that they need this compatibility mechanism in place. Although, to be fair, I could start the Microsoft Works that was installed from within Windows 3.1 also directly from the Windows desktop, and it did seem to not cause any issues. Of course, having Windows 3.1 side by side to Windows 95 would mean that you would need always to go into the Windows 3.1 desktop first to start your applications. However, if the feature would have made it to the final release, Microsoft would probably have added program links to directly point to the installed programs. Here's a small demo, simply by cloning the existing .pif file, creating a new one for Microsoft Works, adding just msworks.exe to the command line. And voila, now you have a start menu launcher that would go directly into Windows 3.1 and start Microsoft Works from there. I was then also curious to see a later iteration, especially as it was mentioned the capability was still included in build 3.2.8. So I was setting up another DOS Windows 3.1 virtual machine from which to launch the build 3.2.8 setup. The install folder on this ISO image looks already pretty much as on the final release, and so does the setup program. Build 3.2.8 was available in January 1995, so still 6 months before the final version was released to manufacturing in July 1995. However, one can see immediately how much more advanced this already was, as when compared to January 1994's build 1.16. The beta release notes don't include any further hints on the Windows 3.1 compatibility mode, but the files should still be there. And there they are, so I'm repeating the same procedure as shown before, and...
May I comment on that?
Bummer, although the files are still there, they seem to not work anyway. Now, it didn't come as a total surprise, as it was mentioned here how the method for advertising the Windows version to Win16 applications has changed, originally reporting a version 4.0, but changing it to report version 3.95 during later development stages of Windows 95. So I was calling up Sourcer, a disassembly tool, and ran it on win31.exe. Sourcer gives me a notice on startup that it found an NE segment, a so-called new executable. This means nothing else that win31.exe is a hybrid program consisting of both a DOS and a Windows executable part. The DOS version of Sourcer would only be able to decompile the DOS segment, but that's fine for now. I'll end up with a win31.lst file, which includes the disassembled program, and I'll quickly fire it up in Notepad. It shouldn't be hard to find, as the segment we're after should be bound to a CMP mnemonic. And here it is. I know it's a bit hard to read because of the low screen resolution, but already scrolling sideways reveals what the disassembler believes to happen here. We see a jump to another segment if the test was 0 or equal, otherwise it loads the data segment, which will later bring us said error message. Now, simply patching this from hex 74, which is the opcode for jump if 0 or equal, to EB, which is the opcode for an unconditional jump, will simply bypass this version check. Just by doing so, Windows 3.1 will already start up, although I'm still getting another message claiming it needs Windows 95. This can simply be confirmed and Windows 3.1 seems to work just fine, but let's get rid of that second check as well. Now that we know what to look for, it should be easy to spot. And here it is at offset 827 hex. So again, changing the opcode from 74 to EB should do the trick. And so it does. So I applied the same patch to both versions of win31.exe as I then wanted to see it fly in Windows 95. And to no surprise, it works just fine using both the 116 and the 328 versions of win31.exe.
What about Windows Me?
I totally don't get your obsession with Windows Me, but here we are. As Windows Me doesn't have the real MS-DOS mode, I had to apply the community patch as featured in a previous episode. Only this allowed me to carry out the parallel install of Windows 3.1 from inside MS-DOS 8, as I essentially had to drop out to MS-DOS mode. I then repeated the same steps as before, only to find that at least the version coming from build 116 was crashing Windows Me. The version from build 328 was better, as it started just okay, also switching between the two UIs as well as exiting properly. The only thing not working was the mouse. I didn't investigate into this one, but I could imagine that the mouse driver found in Windows ME was refreshed for the WDM, the Windows driver model, whereas the original driver I had was supposed to work alongside with the VXD drivers. But that's a pure speculation. At least the proof is made that it still can be used somewhat on Windows ME if one really wanted to. Now, I did one last check to see how compatible it really was. So far, I only had tested it on an English version of Windows 3.1 against the English versions of Windows 9X. So I gave it a shot using a German copy of Windows for Workgroups 3.11, and it too worked just fine.
The original vision of a computer on every desk and in every home is slowly but surely coming true.
So why did Microsoft drop this interesting feature at last? As suggested, it would probably have led to the same situation as IBM was struggling with on OS 2. OS2 didn't have a huge pool of native applications, and using the very stable Win95 emulation, nobody could really bother. But it would also lead to development companies not adapting OS2, but staying on Windows, because there was no reason to develop native applications. If Windows 95 really had to rely on a Windows 3.1 compatibility layer that runs in a separate session, people would probably have thought of Windows 95 being not as compatible as claimed. And granted, it was also not very comfortable the way it was presented, and actually a big step back if compared to OS2, which could run Windows applications seamlessly integrated onto the workplace shell. So Microsoft did what ultimately was the only reasonable way, investing into making Windows 95's Win16 subsystem totally stable, so they could do away with the need to have a separate Windows 3.1 system coexisting underneath. Well, what do you think about it? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday.